Okay, my name's Kelvin Montague. I'm with the Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection team, and we're running a seminar on managing sclerotinia root rot or rot in vegetable crops with Len Tesoriero next to me. This particular webinar is also brought to us by another project called Vegetable Soilborne Disease Management, VG15010. So that's the project where we do a lot of the research around these soilborne diseases. And this today we'll be talking specifically about sclerotinia. In terms of how to interact, please ask questions. We've got a presentation which we'll go through, and then we'll have a substantial amount of time for your questions. We ask if you can put your questions in earlier rather than later, because what I'll do is try and group them together and pose the questions to Len. But if you can get them in earlier, then that will help. Also, we find that there tends to be, straight after the presentation, a bit of a lull, and then suddenly we'll get a flurry of questions just as we are about to wrap up. So if you can get them in early, that would be great. I think I've briefly mentioned the question box, so that should be fairly straightforward. Just type your question in and it'll come through to us. So without further ado, I'll hand you over to Len to talk to us about sclerotinia rot.
Thanks, Kelvin. So sclerotinia is a fungus, it's a true fungus. Some of you who might have listened to my talk last time on Pythium, we talked about how Pythium was really an algal relative, but sclerotinia is related to a few other types of fungi that you might be familiar with. Botrytis, which is the grey mould fungus, and that occurs on a wide range of plants. And things like monolinia, which is the cause of brown rot diseases, particularly in stone fruit. Gets confused sometimes with sclerotian rot, which is caused by the fungus sclerotian rolfsii, and they're not closely related. They are related, but not closely. Sclerotian rolfsii is a basidiomycete, so it's related to some of the higher toadstools and mushrooms, whereas sclerotinia is in this group called the ascomycetes. So we'll restrict our talk today to sclerotinia. Now, there's a little bit of a debate as to whether it's just one species or two species or three species. Basically, it's generally known to be two different species. So there's sclerotinia sclerotiorum and sclerotinia minor, and they're separated as much as anything in the past by the little black sclerotia that they form and the size of them. And sclerotinia minor, as the name suggests, has much smaller sclerotia than sclerotinia sclerotiorum. There is another sclerotinia in the literature that appeared quite early, and I had some correspondence recently that with some genetic studies that maybe it may be, distinguished from sclerotinia sclerotiorum. And it has sclerotia in that sort of mid-size, so that 0.3 to 10 millimetre size. So
Len, in terms of field diagnostics, the main characteristics you look for are the size.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, that seems to be the main way of distinguishing it, sort of without going into genetic studies. Look, they all have a fairly wide host range, although the trifoliorum one seems to be, as the name suggests again, more restricted. It was known to occur on legumes, but it also does get onto things like lettuce and celery. So that's one question for the future research in Australia, is to know whether or not, from a genetic point of view, whether sclerotinia sclerotiorum is all one thing, or whether this trifoliorum is also present, and whether there's some biological differences between them. So there may be some issues with host range. As you can see there, sclerotinia sclerotiorum occurs on more than 400 plant species. And in fact, some work has shown over the years, and in fact, years like this year, So native species can be attacked, and I remember an occasion out near Broken Hill where sclerotinia was found affecting a lot of, around this time of year when you get a big flourish of native plants in the desert environment, but also along the east coast. So back in 2000 there was examples where a number of different native plants were shown to be infected with sclerotinia sclerotiorum. So the common names for sclerotinia diseases kind of vary, and they're quite descriptive. So one of the key features besides those black sclerotia is this cottony growth of the fungal threads. So it's called white mold on things like beans and a few other crops. In cabbages, it also, that cottony growth can also extend to some soft rot conditions. So it's called cottony soft rot, or can be called cottony soft rot. When it occurs on seedlings, that generic name damping off can be used. In celery, where the main part of the celery, the petiole, effectively turns a bit pink coloured, it can be called pink rot. And in tomatoes, it's variously called stem rots, but also timber rot is a name you might find in the literature. In lettuce, where the plant just collapses, it's called drop disease, and that can be both of the different sclerotinias that could cause that. And then it also obviously affects things like beans in post-harvest and other fruiting crops like cucumbers. And when you get this sort of patch or ball of white mycelium, the white cottony growth around some of those fruit, it's called nesting. So those names, as I say, are pretty descriptive. There's a couple of pictures there of sclerotinia on tomato stems, and you can see there on the left sclerotinia sclerotiorum with those big black sclerotia, so they're sometimes described a bit like rat dung. And then on the right, that more, I guess, brown appearance of the stem with the smaller sclerotia, that's probably more typical of what people might call timber rot, where it kind of turns into a woody appearance. And you can see that stem on the right is cracked as well, and quite often in a lot of different plant species with a hollow pith, those sclerotia will form up the pith of inside of the stem. So again, things like in beans and the like, you might find the sclerotia forming inside the plant.
So Len, how evident in the field are the sclerotia?
They're pretty obvious as the disease develops. In that initial phase, you may just see, as for example, in the one on the right, that white cottony growth, and eventually those cottony growth kind of gives rise to almost little beads, which then eventually blacken as the tissue hardens up. So those sclerotia are really just structures that form from a mat or a accumulation of the fungal hyphal threads, and they become resilient resting structures. There's a couple of examples of lettuce drops, so you can see there the collapse of the plant and that sort of brown watery growth around ground level. And on the right hand side, you can actually see again those black sclerotia forming associated with the white cottony growth.
So if you pick the leaves up on that lettuce on the left, you'll see,
yes, you may find sclerotia. You might find both either of the larger sclerotia or the smaller ones. So that could be sclerotinia sclerotiorum or sclerotinia minor. So let's look at the conditions favouring sclerotinia rots, and it is a cool temperature pathogen. So in many parts of Australia, you'll find sclerotinia rots occurring mostly in the winter or in the shoulder seasons up north. So it might be in the spring period or in the autumn period, but generally associated with wet conditions or humid weather conditions, and that temperature range between about 15 and 21 being the main conditions under which this particular fungus enjoys it, but it can survive at higher temperatures. In particular, sclerotinia sclerotiorum produces some sexual spores, which I'll show you in a minute, which don't like to the conditions above 21. They don't survive for very long in those warmer temperatures. So you'll find it in the cooler, wet parts of the year. A bit like with that lettuce, you'll see dense plantings where there's lush canopy covering the soil surface are important. So again, as with things like carrots, as the plants develop and you start to get senescing leaves in contact with the moist soil, or with lettuces the same, you have those sort of microenvironments that form which allow the infection to take place. Obviously where you've got monocultures and you've got crop upon crop, you'll generally get higher levels of sclerotinia and a build-up of those sclerotia, those resting bodies in the soils. And also where you've got crop residues. So if you've picked crops and you've got old remaining bits, so in brassica crops, for example, you'll find that the sclerotinia will survive and more sclerotia will develop even after you've harvested the main part of the crop. I've got that picture there of some cucumber fruit, and it's to show that actually sclerotinia rots also occur in protected cropping environments, and in particular even in soilless environments. So inside greenhouses you can get sclerotinia, and you can see that in that case it's getting up on the fruit. So we should look at the life cycle of sclerotinia, and this one's a stylized life cycle for sclerotinia sclerotiorum, and I'll have to explain that sclerotinia minor misses that bit in the middle. So if we start down at the bottom right where you can see those little black sclerotia, they're the survival structures that are in the soil. They germinate, so they can germinate to make fungal threads, as you can see over at the bottom right, bottom left, I should say. And so those fungal threads can then attack the roots or around the collar of the plant, causing initial infection. And in the case of a young seedling, obviously it'd cause a damping off disease. In the case of, say, in lettuce, it might cause that drop symptom as it starts to rot away at the base of the plant. The other part of the life cycle is the sexual phase, where these sort of mushroom-like structures are formed on the soil surface as the sclerotia germinate, so that if they've germinated close to the soil surface, they'll produce little structures that come up above the soil surface and produce what we call ascospores, which are sexual derived spores from a sexual reproduction, and they become airborne. So that allows for infection, as you saw in those cucumber fruit and in beans and in carrots. You get infection via these ascospores, and generally they can't actually get into healthy plant tissue. They require to either go in through senescing flowers, which they can colonise that tissue, and then the infection can go back through into the fruit, or when those flowers drop or move around, they can land on another piece of plant healthy tissue, and the mycelium that's growing in those floral fragments can then infect directly into the plant. So that sexual phase can be very important. It's kind of strange that when you look at, say, something like carrots, where you've got old leaves senescing on the soil surface, it's not so much the mycelium infection that, as you would think, might be the most important, but somehow the ascospores seem to have to infect those senescing leaves, which then give rise to the infection in carrots. And so that then, obviously, as the plant's infected, it generates more of those sclerotia, and then the cycle goes round.
So Len, what's the relative importance of the infection from the soil, from the mycelium and that airborne spores blowing in?
Yeah, well, it kind of depends, because again, I should have pointed out that sclerotinia minor doesn't produce those apothecia and ascospores. So generally it's going around right around the outside of the circle. So it's going from sclerotia to mycelium. So there's really little evidence that they produce apothecia and nascus spores at all. In terms of sclerotinia sclerotiorum, I was a bit surprised to find out that the ascus spores were important in the infection of the and necessary for the infection process to occur. So it's a little bit strange to me. There's many mysteries that I don't really know enough about in terms of why that should be the case.
And the spores have some specific environmental conditions they require?
Well, as I said earlier, the temperature regime is important. So those ascus spores, those sexual spores, don't survive for very long above 21 degrees. And as with a lot of airborne spores, they tend not to survive very well in ultraviolet light. So they tend ultraviolet light is a good sterilant in a way, so it'll desiccate or kill them off. So they won't survive very long in warm, sunny conditions. And so that's why, again, that cool, moist, probably cloudy conditions, if you like, are going to be conducive for disease development. So just in summary then, when we look at sclerotinia sclerotiorum, the life cycle, those sclerotia, we go either via the asexual path, which is the mycelia, which can directly infect roots and if it's at the soil surface around the collar of the plant. Or you can produce those mushroom-like apothecia, which are the sexual phase. Now, that sexual phase is important when I come to talk about some of the control measures, in particular when we talk about pesticide resistance or fungicide resistance, because, as you know, any child is not exactly the same as the parent, so there's throwing up new forms all the time, and included in that might be the ability to be able to become resistant to fungicides. So in that case, we need to be quite mindful of fungicide resistance, particularly with sclerotinia sclerotiorum. That mycelia we were talking about, so in both cases, after the ascus spores have actually colonised flower parts or leaves or senescing leaves, or where the mycelia itself has directly penetrated the plant, there's a production of enzymes that affect cell walls, and quite often you'll get this sort of watery soaked spots and that watery soft rot accompanying that cottony growth that you could see on some of those pictures earlier. So those ascus spores, as I said, infect senescing flower petals that then colonise the fruit or other vegetative parts. And it's been shown that insects such as bees attending flowers can actually help spread ascus spores. So that's something that before I read about it, I didn't know either. Mm,
just before you go on.
Yeah.
That with the little mushrooms, Len, how easy, how big are they and how easy are they to find? Are they reasonable in terms of a diagnostic?
There's a picture on this slide. They're about the size of a 10-cent piece and smaller, so they're not very big. They're not like true mushrooms and toadstools where the gills underneath form the spores. In this case, the spores are actually on the upper surface, and it's usually during wet conditions that they enable the release of those ascus spores, and those ascus spores can be injected into the air, and because they're so small, they will float off and basically can travel quite a distance. But as I said, there's actually things like bees that can also spread them around. I wanted to talk a little bit about disease forecasting. And it's been attempted in North America, and I was reading a paper which sort of summarised a lot of the work that had been done, quite a lot of research looking at what we call the epidemiology of the disease, where people look at the sort of conditions under which infection can occur, the conditions that best favour the survival of those resting structures. And it hasn't really been a successful approach in many places in North America. I understand it has been used a bit and is being used a bit in Europe, but some of the reasons why it's difficult to get good accurate disease forecasting is that the disease seems to be quite sporadic in space and time. In a lot of work that's been done, there's not a good correlation between estimating the number of sclerotia in the soil and the subsequent disease levels that occur. There's another issue, and that is that particularly where people are looking at for those apothecia, those little structures, they tend to occur underneath plant canopies, and in fact where they were doing this work, they actually could detect ascospores in the air, but they hadn't actually detected the structures that give rise to them. So they're easily overlooked and a bit time consuming and difficult to find. And you'd probably need to get your eye in. You can see in that picture there, there's not a huge contrast between the soil colour and the actual colour of the structures themselves. In some of the previous work in Australia, the researchers have developed ascospore detection methods and using molecular techniques. Maybe that's something that could be looked at further in the future, but at this stage, it's still in a state of hiatus.
So Len, when you say the disease is sporadic in space and time, and then it's coming back to weather conditions mainly, is that what you're saying? And
well, there'll be other issues associated with the soil and the biology and some of the microclimates that might occur. So for example, if you've got a field where there are some areas that stay wetter longer, if you've used fertilisers and maybe in some areas of the field the fertilisers have given you a bit more of lush growth, or if there's been an issue with planting density, so somewhere along the line some of the plants are a bit more dense than others, maybe there were some other issues earlier in the cropping phase where the plants didn't establish as well, and so you've got areas uniformity, if that's a word, across your block, then you might find that the disease will appear in some places more than others. And it's not just directly related back to the number of sclerotia you might detect at the beginning of the crop.
So this spring, you know, pretty much across the country has been a bit of an unusual one. It's a lot wetter, cooler. So I guess if people are seeing sclerotinia out there, then you know, drop us a line on the questions, or you know, let us know what your observations are out in the field, because it'd be this sort of season that you'd expect to see
a good
infestation rate.
There's one contrasting thing, just makes you realise that biology is never simple, and that is that if soils become anaerobic, the sclerotial survival is actually decreased. So they do need to respire a little bit. So if there's very low oxygen levels because the soil's become anaerobic, quite often that actually gives rise to the fact that the sclerotial number actually decreases, and so that can actually affect the subsequent disease level. It's not a simple cause and effect thing. So I'll move onto some integrated management strategies, and I guess that's the key theme, that it's not going to be just one strategy that you can use. And in many cases, fungicides can be quite useful. It seems that for transplants, the sort of fungicide regimes are a bit more successful. So, for example, with brassicas and lettuces, getting that application soon after transplanting, it seems to be really important, and then having a follow-up. As I said, particularly with Sclerotinia scleroideorum, it's going to be important to manage for resistance, and so when you look on the labels, obviously, you'll see that, you know, the recommendation is not to use more than two sprays of one of the products. Just be careful, because I noticed, for example, that Phelan, which is Bosculid, so it's in group 7. You've also got Fontellus registered on some products. That's also in the same group. So you've got to make sure that you're moving from one group to another. So, for example, you might look at an alternative chemical from other groups. So looking at something like switch or something like that that could be used as a follow-up. Fumigation is...
Just before we jump onto that, just a question. You know, you talked about the life cycles and the fact that sclerotinia minor sort of skips a sexual phase.
Mm-hmm.
Does that affect that its resistance, given that it's not going to... its genetic, or its ability to change its DNA is a little less going through the asexual way?
Generally speaking, any organism that has a sexual phase tends to have the ability to throw up new genetic variants that might be, you know, have resistance. But in the end, you know, resistance is also a matter of, you know, how much mutation is occurring for one reason or another. So I couldn't actually say specifically, but I'm speaking generally, I suppose. The other factor is that when you've got large numbers of spores being produced, again, you've got a number of individuals, so the selection pressure is based also upon the number of organisms you're talking about. So in the case of producing ascospores, you've got masses of those, excuse me, ascospores that just increase. It's a bit of a numbers game. So, you know, I guess the other thing people have used is fumigation, so something like methane sodium, and it's pretty well known that that can give you short-term efficacy, so you can get control in the short term, but you do have this problem of the fact that you can get recolonisation of the plant pathogen, either from areas outside or where the fumigation itself hasn't gone deep enough. So these types of soil-borne fungi can come back. And on top of that, you can get enhanced biodegradation where various, particularly bacteria that are resident in the soil, actually find the fumigant to be a food source. And so again, you're selecting for particular organisms that are going to break it down quicker, and that quicker breakdown means that the half-life of the chemical is reduced, and that way its efficacy can be reduced.
So is that, enhanced biodegradation of your, you know, your methane sodiums and the likes, is that a problem that we're seeing there?
Well, it has been found in, for example, in Western Australia in carrots, in those sandy soils. So again, I'm sort of generalising. It may occur more on certain soil types than others. Certainly, there's evidence that it does occur. And as we were talking about the, you know, wet soil conditions, so irrigation scheduling is important. So if you can avoid having soils that stay wet on the surface in particular, not just for this particular disease, but other diseases like rhizoctonia, which can grow on wet soil and like wet soil conditions on the surface of the soil. Nutrition management, again, to do with that leafiness, so having lush, soft growth enables not just this plant pathogen, but many plant pathogens to be able to be favoured. You get that microenvironment in around the base of the plant.
We've got a question just in relation to fungicide resistance.
Yep.
I guess, you know, we just talked about that a bit.
Yep.
Are there specific examples where fungicides have become less? I guess we've seen it with methane sodium. You typically see a really good control of most things, and then it just wanes over time.
Well, that's more in the enhanced biodegradation. Yeah. And, you know, the other example with Western Australian carrots was with metalaxyl, which is, you know, one of the products being Ritamil, and they found the half-life of Ritamil reduced from something like 60 days down to about 4 days. So, again, you have, in this case, bacteria that are actually using it as a food source. There's many examples of fungicide resistance where the actual fungus has become resistant. So, well, we don't use the benzimidazole fungicides anymore, but that was well documented that a single genetic base change gave rise to resistance, a stable resistance in that particular fungicide group. So people might remember things like benlate and carbendazim, and thiobendazole and the like, and so that whole group of fungicides lost its their ability to control some diseases because of that that related organism botrytis. So I think you've got in some crops some of the group 2 fungicides registered, so resistance is also known to occur in the group 2 fungicides, so that's epridione and well, you've lost pyrimidine now, but epridione, which is, you know, the old product Rovril, you can get resistance developed in that, although it's not as stable, so once the chemical is not used, the resistant lines don't seem to be as fit and they go away. What else is there? In the group 3s, you've got tebuconazole, which is registered for some crops for sclerotinia control, and resistance is known to occur in that. So virtually, you know, all the groups, there will be some chance of resistance developing. In the group 7s, I don't know that there's any, I could be wrong because I haven't really looked it up, sclerotinia resistance that's developed in Australia, and I'm not even sure if it's developed anywhere, but I know that, for example, in botrytis, for the group 7s, there's some resistance that has developed. So, you know, sometimes it does depend on the actual the fungus itself as to how much chance of the resistance there is of developing, but it is a threat, and it's something, particularly given that something like Feelan's got a very, it survives for a good amount of time in the soil, so it actually gives very good control. So the longer that's present and the longer the fungus is present with it, the greater the chance the resistance will develop. So it's, I guess the point is not over-relying on the fungicides, and that's why as we go down the list, we start looking at some of the other strategies that could be useful. Crop density, so again, that's not always easy. I know that...
I'll just get you to pause there, Len, for a moment. But you know, really, we've got some pretty effective fungicides for sclerotinia, but resistance is an issue that looms all the time.
Yeah.
And if you're totally reliant on the fungicide, then we're going to get resistance, and you're going to lose that.
Yeah, it's not a matter of if, it's when.
So really, by having this sort of more integrated management strategies, you're not putting all the eggs in one basket. And by hopefully doing that, the fungicides that we've got will keep their efficacy for longer. So I guess that's why we sort of got a whole list of things, because if you rely solely on that first one, the fungicides, the ones that you're going to grab to when you get a disease outbreak, then if you use it all the time, then you won't have that option.
Yeah, and that's why, again, the labels specify quite clearly, you know, to only use a maximum of 2 applications of the one product in a crop. But then, you know, if we're doing intensive cropping and we're growing several crops a year, we need to think that, you know, we need to manage that even more. So I've noticed on some labels now they might say things like only X number of applications per year rather than, say 2 or 3 per crop.
Yeah, because if you're growing a baby leaf, then, you know, you might be out through that crop in 30 days.
And you might have, you know, 5 crops in the same block in a year. So... So where do we get to? Cropping density is something that's obviously trying to get more airflow through around the base of the plant. Not always practical, but maybe, it's a kind of a diminishing return issue if you've got a high disease pressure that, you know, you may be better off sowing less to get more. Non-hosts, well, as I said, you know, there's for a probably quite limited opportunity to look at non-hosts in many of the intensive veggie production situations. So you might be able to go into something like an allium or something, but for most people that's probably not an option. With weed management, and it kind of goes without saying really, that weeds could also potentially host these particular pathogens, and similarly, as I was talking about with flowers, so that flower infection and the fact that even bees that might move in and out of crops might actually also be spreading ascospores. So if so that's another aspect, I suppose. Now we get down to, I think some of the really...
I'm just going to stop, pause you there. In terms of rotation, I've got a question there from Brock, and please keep the questions coming because we've got a few there that we'll get around to. But in terms of rotation, there is some evidence in the literature that a broccoli, a lettuce crop following a broccoli crop has got less susceptibility. So there are some minor tweaks, but you know, as Len said, that sclerotinia has such a broad host range, it does cause problems with rotation. But certainly if you're going lettuce, 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 or a very susceptible crop continuously, the incidence will go up. And so by incorporating something that's a bit more tolerant, resistant, I don't want to use the word resistant, then you can just reduce the pressure. And certainly broccoli falls into that. But Len, our discussion was that cabbage is more tolerant, more...
Well, it's just that you'll find Sclerotinia sclerotiorum affecting cabbages. And I've been to farms in Western Sydney where I've seen, you know, cabbage lettuce rotations. It's, you know, in the Sydney guys, that's one of the key rotations. And I've seen very heavily infected lettuce crops that have followed cabbages or even cauliflower. So, yeah, I guess... You know, we can talk about things generally, but in the end, there's always going to be exceptions. And again, that's the weather conditions that can really be the key factor. So let's look at some interventions that are, I think probably some of the key areas where, you know, management is going to be more sustainable, and that's applying compost. So compost not only improve the soil condition itself, but they actually enable beneficial microbes to develop, and that's sort of a key area of interest in that it's what we call generalized suppression, where you get a range of different microbials that can attack the sclerotia directly, or they can inhibit the sclerotia from developing, or they can inhibit the germination of the sclerotia. So good quality composts, and I sort of emphasise good quality composts, because poorly composted material may actually allow sclerotinia to grow saprophytically. So you can actually increase your inoculum by using poor quality material. So you want good quality composted material. And that leads me on to microbial biocontrols themselves. So there are a number of different beneficial bacteria and fungi that have been used. In the case of the fungi, a lot of you are probably aware of things like trichodermas. There's a range of different products around. And they work as hyperparasites. Kind of interestingly, I noticed in some of the previous work that's been done with Sclerotinia minor, it wasn't so much the trichoderma actually attacking the sclerotia and infecting the sclerotia and killing them. It was more that they seemed to prevent the germination of the sclerotia, which was a bit of a surprise to me. Although I've seen other overseas work that tends to say that the sclerotia become parasitised by these beneficials. There's another one called Coniotharium, which is a commercial product overseas that may eventually find its way to Australia, and that's a beneficial fungus that acts as a hyperparasite.
So Len, when you're talking about the microbial controls, that's introducing the trichodermes or the bacillus into the system.
Yeah.
Are we talking about putting them onto the soil, into the soil, or are we talking about onto the plant surfaces and stopping those spores?
Okay. So, this is a critical point, because use patterns are going to be pretty important. So in some of the work that was done in Australia, and I should say that there was a pretty big study done on Sclerotinia from about 2007 to 2010. So there was led by a group in Victoria, from the Victorian department. There's people in Queensland and people in Tasmania that have also worked on this in this area. And it seemed that one of the key results was that particularly transplants, by putting these biocontrols into the seedlings, into the seedling mix, you got very good control of disease following that. So that was quite a useful strategy. Where the biocontrol agents were actually put on at that level. With things like the coniatharium overseas, it's something that's seen as used. You can put it on in the soil, but it's really something that builds up and reapplied over a couple of seasons. So if you've got a paddock that has a high incidence of sclerotinia, you can't just rely on putting a biocontrol agent on and I guess using it as you might use a fungicide. You've really got to be reapplying it and using it over a period of time to reduce the inoculum in that particular area. The other one, excuse me, is some of the bacteria, the bacillus species. And it's been shown they act a bit differently. They produce antibiotics, so they're able to suppress some of the active phase of the sclerotinia fungus, generally the hyphal growth. Mm-hmm. And then finally, we come to cover crops and biofumigants, and I might hand over to you.
That's good timing, because you need a break, I think.
Yeah, I'm just running out of voice.
Just a couple of questions before we go on to cover crops is a question in terms of the spores and how long do they hang around for?
The ascospores?
Yeah, so like let's say it's an optimal condition, it's 20 degrees, we're down in Tassie now at the moment, it's overcast, 20 degrees, high humidity, how long will the spores hang around for?
Generally things like ascospores won't hang around for a long period of time, so you're really talking about hours and days. As I said, that Their ability to survive is dependent on temperature and probably UV light. So if you're down or out in the sun rays or riverina or something, they probably won't only last a few hours.
Yeah.
Whereas if you're down in Tassie or something like that, they might last a day or two. Generally, you know, they'll settle and then they'll want to germinate. And you can imagine, given the sort of vast numbers that are produced, it's a bit of a numbers game. So if there's a lot of them, there's more chance that some of them will succeed in causing infections. If there's only a few of them, obviously there won't be.
So if you're a typical veggie growing situation where you're doing plantings over different periods, you've got this planting, then you
successive plantings.
Successive. Then the potential to infect the next planting is
very much high. And that's why that getting rid of residues of crops once they've been picked is pretty important. But I've again seen, not just for this particular disease, but with a lot of diseases, you'll see carryover from the older crops into the younger crops, even viruses and the vectors that can move infections from older plantings to younger plantings.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of the, I guess, difficulties of particularly if you're limited for land and you've got your successive plantings butted up against each other.
Well, it's something to keep an eye on, even more so when you've got that and you've got conditions over it.
Yeah.
I'm going to go and talk a little bit about cover crops. Before I do, Len, I'm going to give you a little question on notice, and that's around solarisation and the impact on scrotia.
Yep.
So we'll come back to that after I've done a little bit on the cover crops. I'm just going to do a little cameo on cover crops. We'll be talking more about cover crops in the next month or so with myself doing an overview of cover crops and their role in veggie production, and then also Julie Finnegan from Survag and Taz is going to talk specifically about biofumigants. So I'm just going to really focus on sclerotinia and cover crops, and I guess one of the reasons why I did this when I was talking with Len is that we're currently putting together a trial which is looking at aiming to control sclerotinia, and one of the things we're doing is putting cover crops in that. So in doing that, we had to scratch our head and work out what do we do given this wide host range, how do we select a cover crop? So you can use cover crops to reduce the pressure, and I guess it's part of that integrated pest management approach is, trying to reduce your pressure so that you're not totally reliant on your chemicals. Cover crop choice is limited when sclerotinia is an issue. You know, Len said there's over 400 plant species in the table in the book. It just goes on for pages. So most families are affected. So you do have to choose carefully, because the last thing you want to do is actually breed up the pathogen, and cover crops can do that if you don't choose the right one. So in terms of cover crop options, then generally if you've got a real major sclerotinia issue, then grasses are a good option. They're a monocot, they're less susceptible to sclerotinia, but they still do host it, and I've just cut and pasted the little bit out of the book which was listing all the species, and you'll see in the table below there, you'll see the usual suspects in terms of cover crops of oats, barley, rye, sorghum, wheat, maize. They're all susceptible to sclerotinia. So they're still susceptible, but they're certainly a lot less so than most of our dicots, particularly legumes. And I see, you know, I didn't realise there was actually a specific species of sclerotinia that would attack legumes. So you do have to be careful with your legumes. So why do we go to grasses? Well, which wrong computer. Grasses have some special tricks. So true cereals, and that's the ones in the list there, have a plant defence against sclerotinia. And what they do is that the sclerotinia produce a lot of oxalic acid. So that's the toxin that it basically allows the fungus hyphae and spores to germinate and to get access to the plant. Now, what the plants do is both the roots and I think the leaves as well produce an enzyme which actually breaks this oxalic acid down so it doesn't damage the plant root or the leaf. So it actively actually reduces it, and also as part of that breakdown, it produces hydrogen peroxide, and that also helps the plant protect against the fungi, because the peroxide induces a local response which essentially hardens the root or the leaf up, and the fungal mycelium can't access it. So that's the stuff, and we've known about this in grasses for, I don't know, 30 or 40 years. And in fact, they've actually transgenically taken the gene that produces the enzyme out of the grass, out of barley and wheat, and put it into peanuts, which had no resistance, and they see resistance actually increased, or there's some resistance there in the peanuts. So they've done that for a couple of crops. So what do we see when we look in the field? And the table below shows the sequence of cover crop and then a lettuce crop, which is obviously susceptible, and then the numbers on that. And I've got my little pointer. I've got a pointer there. The numbers on the right-hand side. So when you grow lettuce, the lettuce drop incidence was about 30%. When you had a grass preceding the lettuce, either a rye or a sedan grass, you roughly halved the incidence of lettuce drop. So quite a large decrease. The next one down is when we put a legume in vetch, we see the same or even higher than following lettuce. So vetch is actually one of those legumes which seems to be quite susceptible to a lot of the soil-borne diseases. And certainly as a rule of thumb, if I had a soil-borne disease, a paddock with a lot of soil-borne disease issues, epithium, sclerotinia, etc., then I'd be avoiding vetch as a rule of thumb. But I want you to look at the next one, the bottom of that, and that's when we mix a grass with a legume. And you'll see the leaf drop incidence drops down to what it was if you just grew the grass. So it's actually indicating that the grass will actually protect what's with it, in this case the vetch. The other thing I'd say about legumes is there's a large range in terms of the susceptibility and the impact on the following crop. And for example, your just normal field peas is particularly susceptible to sclerotinia and seem to promote it. The one that seemed to come out really well was our broad beans. So in terms of us designing a winter cover crop, we're looking at something like a barley broad bean type mix, and that's what we'll be trialling in one of the trials down in Tassie. So you can keep an eye out, and we'll see how that goes. So that's one approach, is to try and, I guess, starve out the sclerotinia by not hosting it, and then hopefully there'll be some biology in the soil which will attack the sclerotia and reduce the incidence. So it's trying to just reduce the pressure as a whole. The other approach is, I'm going to skip that one. I didn't realise I had that in. The other approach is to go to a biofumigant approach, and that's where you grow a specific crop, in this case a brassica, to directly reduce either the sclerotia or the fungal growth to control the disease or reduce its pressure. Now, the first word of warning is that if you're going to go down the route of this of a biofumigant, is you've got to make sure that you're managing the biofumigant crop so it has a good effect, because brassicas are susceptible to sclerotinia and you can breed it up. So generally, if you follow the incidence of sclerotinia or it's the amount of mycelium or something, you'll find it goes up over time as you're growing the brassica. But then when you incorporate it, the biofumigant effect knocks it out. And I'll just briefly go through the charts. So it has two potential ways that the biofumigant can impact on sclerotinia. And the first way I've got on the chart is through inhibiting the germination of the sclerotia. And then if you look on the far right, the bar graph, that's the amount of sclerotia that germinate out of 30. So about 20 out of 30 germinated. And then as you add in the white bars are the 2 grams of material that was added into this pot trial, and that was showing a reduction in germination. And hopefully on the slide you'll be able to see the actual species along them, but they are our usual biofumigant suspects that we use. So if you want specific details, just have a look at the actual presentation when we put it up. So the second way is biofumigants will actually slow the mycelium growth, so that's the asexual phase. And again, this graph shows the percentage reduction. So those big white bars, again, are the rate. The black bits are 1 gram, the white bits are 2 grams. But you can see there's a couple of biofumigants. Calliente is the one that I remember is quite effective at slowing fungal growth. And so that's basically reducing it by around about 90%. Interestingly, the Calliente is not quite as effective at inhibiting sclerotia germination. So I think, Julie, in about a month or so, we'll talk a lot more about biofumigants and their management. But yes, you can use this. And David East in WA, on one of our demo sites over there, has used biofumigants to reduces incidence in lettuce quite successfully. I'm not sure if David's online. I haven't seen him, but drop us a message, and if you're happy to talk, we might get you to just to say a few words.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, that sort of sums it all up. There's a couple of things while we're waiting. Have we got some questions?
Mm. Yeah, we have. But if you want to do the...
Well, there are a couple of other things that I...
Solarisation and sprint through.
There are a couple of things I mentioned that anaerobic soil conditions can reduce the survival of sclerotia, but solarisation, actually heating the soil up, is another approach. Of course, that won't work in all parts of Australia. So obviously, up in the northern parts of Australia, it may be more useful. So yes, it is a strategy. It's again, one of those things where, particularly if you're using, it's preferable to use clear plastic, so there's labour required in all of that. And so, it's questionable as to whether it's a better process than just going in with a fumigant, because in a sense, you're just killing off a range of different microbes there.
With that question, and we talked about it in terms of fumigation in general, and so it applies to biofumigation, just straight chemical fumigation, and solarisation is you can do maybe 6 inches of soil, but what's happening below that, and will the mycelium just grow back up?
Well, that's the thing. I guess It kind of depends on the survival of the sclerotia below, and they tend to live in the, you know, generally when people have monitored for sclerotia in soil, it's in that sort of 5 to 10 centimetre zone. So, you know, look, it may well be a useful strategy, but as I said, it won't work everywhere in Australia. It may not work in cooler months. It does require a period of time for the solarisation to work. So whether it's any better than any of the other strategies we discussed, then I don't really know. I tend to think that it's one of those things that's a great idea, and if we lived in Israel, maybe it might be a really, you know, useful thing, but I just don't know. It's been around again for longer than I've been around, and it certainly isn't. It doesn't seem to be a thing that's used as much. And I guess at the end of it all, whether you're using solarisation or any of the other things like fumigants, you still need to rebuild a good biological balance back in that soil. So that's why I think the cover crops and the composts still provide probably better alternatives to some of those things that might sort of be killing off a lot of organisms.
John from Queensland's coming in with some comments about solarisation, and obviously the further north you get, the more sunlight and more heat load you've got, the better. And basically saying specifics around, obviously, clear plastic, but 50 micron plastic and not blackened, that the soil needs to be moist and not dry, so you get that heat transfer.
Yeah, thanks, John.
Also just made a comment, John, thanks for these, is that you can treat potting mix really well using solarisation.
So pasteurising or solarising,
There's a few questions coming in around compost and whether, you know, obviously there's a range of soil biology, soil bacteria and composts, and you know, you can buy products, you can buy a bacillus type product and put it on, or you can make it, because it'll be in your compost. So, you know, that is an option.
There's an interesting debate around all of that in terms of, and going back to about 1980, I saw one of my colleagues who'd done his PhD looking at a bacillus subtilis, and he was showing, in particular, where he was looking at the effectiveness against different strains of or species of Pythium, that sometimes can work quite specifically. And so that's why he actually started working in composting science, where you have what we call this more generalised suppression rather than a specific strain of something. Another thing that was talked about in the work that was done down in Victoria and Tasmania, I think it might have been in Hong Pong's work in Tasmania, was that she used 2% molasses and it reduced sclerotia survival by 95%, which it's funny because I remember reading the report and I didn't remember it being that much, but anyway, basically what that approach is doing, and I've seen similar work, I think Graham Sterling in Queensland had done a bit of work on, might have been capsicums or something, but by putting, I guess, effectively sugar into the soil, it stimulates a lot of different microbial, particularly bacterial growth, and the suggestion is that perhaps some of those are antagonistic towards the plant pathogens. I don't know if it's always that simple, but that's certainly...
It'd be fairly short-lived, wouldn't it? You'd get a burst of activity, and it wouldn't take long for a 2% molasses to be chewed up.
Yeah, I agree. So again, you know, I'm just reporting on what other people have done and claimed. I just don't know how reliable sometimes those approaches are, whether it's something that might work once or might work in a pot experiment but not so well in the field.
Okay, I've got one for you, and then there's also a cover crop one, so I'll give that one so you've got a bit of time. If the apothecia produce these spores and they'd be millions of them, then surely it'd only take a few sclerotia to infest a crop.
And that's one of the reasons I think that there's not always a good correlation between sclerotial number and the amount of disease. So a few sclerotia can produce a lot of ascospores, and if you just happen to have those ascospores come out at the right time, So for example, with beans and they're just flowering, that's obviously going to be the perfect time for the infections to be successful. And similarly with carrots, as I said, I found it quite interesting that the carrot infections require ascospores on those senescing older leaves. And so if you're just at that growth stage and the ascospores are being released and you're getting this heavy infection, then that's when it'll be more likely to be successful. One thing I did read about with carrots was that, I think I might have said beans when I meant carrots then, but anyway, with carrots, with those senescing leaves, there's a technique overseas called leaf stripping where they actually use some sort of implement that come along and takes away a lot of those senescing leaves, mm-hmm. which are the things that are required for that successful ascospore infection. Mm-hmm. So that's a technique that I've seen in the literature. I don't know if anyone in Australia is doing that in carrots, but be interested to find out.
Yeah, well, if you know of anyone doing that, we'd be interested to hear. Just the last question I've got here is relating to cover crops, and does the amount of biomass of the grass species incorporated influence the suppression? And I think it's a good question, because generally when we think cover crops, we think green manure. So that's about incorporating the above ground biomass, all that foliage back in. But the thing that's really occur also of great impact is, what are the root systems doing? And for a lot of these defence mechanisms, it's actually what the root systems are doing as well. And they can actually be doing a lot of very specific things. So that the green manure, if you like, the bulk organic matter that you're going to incorporate back in, is great for general soil health, you know, building structure, recycling nutrients. But actually, when we start thinking about soil-borne diseases, what the root systems are up to are really interesting, because essentially they're exuding lots of compounds, you know, amino acids, proteins, sugars, all sorts of other things, secondary plant products, and they are effectively farming the soil biology around the roots. Mm. So we're seeing a specific example with the grasses in terms of sclerotinia with this oxidase enzyme. So it's not just so much the bulk material that we're incorporating, but it's actually what the root systems are doing as well. And I guess that's the sort of the mystery of it at the moment. And I guess what's exciting about cover crops at the moment is that we've got this, you know, we've effectively gone back and taking a practice that our grandfathers and grandmothers used to use, it's cover cropping, and we're bringing it into the 21st century, and we've got all these new tools in soil biology that we can now start to look and see, well, what's it actually doing, and can we pick out what traits it is? So that's really an advert for the next seminar on the 10th of November. So I'd like to thank Len for his presentation and question answering. It was great stuff. And also, of course, for the audience, for you participating in giving up your lunch hour. So thanks, and hopefully see you at the next seminar.
Thanks. Where'd we go for time?